session is focused on sleep. And we have Kaustubh with us right now, and we are going to do a little bit of exercises. But I want to set the stage today mainly for focusing on all of the various aspects that we are going to talk about with clearly with sleep. So I'm going to keep bothering Kaustubh about whatever we are doing. We will be basically connecting back to the entire concept of sleep. So Kaustubh, welcome, and I'm going to hand it over to you, but the entire core of today's session is going to be sleep. So mainly I have two themes for you. One is what exactly is the relation of exercise and sleep is what we will explore. And secondly, what are those factors within exercise that either contribute positively or negatively towards sleep behavior? So we will be interested in some insights from exercise psychology as well as some insights related to your experience with athletes. Particularly, many sportsmen have very different sleep cycles. So we would like to hear from you about that as well. So over to you. First, let's get some moving going on and then talk about sleep in that context.
Super. Let's just start moving, like Anand said, and then from there we can have a bit of a discussion. We're going to start off with some very quick stretches today. Not going to have them for very long. So what we're going to do is we're going to begin with the arms. Take them as far back as we can. From there, reach up, stretch up all the way, and then drop them back down. Again, reach back all the way, stretch here, continue, turn them to face each other, point them up, and we drop them down. Let's repeat this for three more repetitions. Stretch back, raise up, stretch up, and drop down. Two more, keep going. Palms facing down at the back. From there, raise up and down. And one more, back, up, and down. Great. From here, we're going to twist now. So what we're going to do is get this arm going down, twist to the side, come back, change the arm, reach this one down, reach this one up, and come back. So you want to reach with both arms going across the body. Keep moving. Let's do five on each side. Great. Next twist is going to be turning back. Okay, super. Getting to the legs now, we're going to go a little wide. Reach for the toes and come back up. Very simple. Even if you can't reach the floor, but keeping the legs straight, reach as low as you can and just stand up. Okay, great. From here, we're going down to the floor. If you have a mat, you could use the mat on the floor. We're going to keep our left leg in the front, send our right leg behind, and from this position, just move the hip down and then sit back. As you sit back, you stretch the hamstring. Once again, lean forward, lift that leg up. We'll then drop it down. sit back, stretch the hamstring. Go back forward one last time. Lift the leg up, drop it down, stretch the hip here. Go back, stretch the hamstring. Now we'll change the leg. We're going to get the right leg forward. Lift that thigh and knee up, push the hip down, knee down, sit back, stretch the hamstring here, forward, push ahead. As you walk back, stretch back. One last time, forward, back. And quick break. Take a couple of seconds. Okay, first movement we're going to do, this is slightly going to bring our heart rate up, is we start with both feet behind us, we bring the left leg ahead, bring it back, right leg ahead, bring it back. We do this at a little higher speed than our stretches. Move it as fast as you can. If you can jump, if you can do this comfortably without having any pain in the knees, you can go for it. Otherwise, just stepping, alternating. Next bit, now we're going to strengthen our back up a little bit. So we lie down on the floor, and today we're only working on the upper body, not the lower body. We're going to inhale, lift up, and go back down really slowly. Don't lift the legs up, only the chest lifts up and goes back down. We're going to do 10 of these. Starting now, let's just do 10, come up, inhale, hold for just a second, and come back. If you can raise your arms all the way behind your ears, that would be great. So you're also stretching your shoulders open while you're at it. Once you finish 10, just take a break again. We're just going to repeat these two exercises again. Take a few seconds. Does anyone need a short water break? I will take that as a no. Okay, once again, starting from the plank. These are called mountain climbers. I'm still to find out why, but they are quite effective. So let's begin, 30 seconds. Don't need to push your hips back. Keep your hips down in that plank and just move the legs. So you're trying to build some flexibility in the hips while also doing some cardio when you're stuck at home. That's the intent with these. Two and one. The closer you can bring your feet to your palms, the better it'll be. And in three, two, one, relax. Breathe. Take a couple of seconds and then lie down on your belly. Again, we'll do arches up and down for 10 repetitions. Now, what we want to think of this for this set is instead of getting short, you want to reach out, get as long and tall as you can as you raise and down. So try not to bend in the arms. Stretch the spine away from you as you lift up. Let's begin. Lie down. 10 repetitions, lifting up and down really slowly. No giving any jerks here. Begin. One. Up, inhale, and back down. Again, inhale as you come up. Two, and continue for eight more. If anybody is facing any back pain with these, please let me know so I can change the exercise to you.
Can you show it again, the first?
Sure.
The upper one.
Just lying down, feet together, hands close to each other, and we just raise the chest up and come back down. Great. If we're done, we're going to do one last round, and then we can just do a couple of cool down stretches. Ready? I hope nobody's gone to sleep. 3, 2, 1, begin. 30 seconds only. Hand close to the palm. Sorry, foot close to the palm. And we keep moving. Ten seconds more. And relax. One last set, lying down on the belly. No rest this time. Let's see if we can move straight to the next exercise. Lying down, arms out. Inhale. Exhale and slowly come back down. For 10 repetitions. Super. Difficult bit is done. Let's just sit down and do a couple of stretches while we bring our heart rate back to normal. Step one, just bring your feet together. We're going to open up the groin. Sit upright. And just focus on your breathing. Great. From here, we're going to lie down on our side, and the leg that's on top, I'm going to hold and pull behind till I feel a stretch in my hips. So both knees bent, top leg pull behind till I feel a stretch on my hips. And you can just relax the neck on this other arm. You don't want to let the hip roll back. Stay on your side. So slowly let that leg go. Change the side that you're lying on. Bend the knees. You can even hold this leg down here. Top foot you hold. Pull behind. Open your hip flexors. That's here. What connects the top of your legs to your hip. This one's a great pose to hold for a few seconds at the end of the day if you spend a lot of time driving or in the chair. In this position all short, so you want to get this opened up and lengthened. And relax. Okay. I hope your breathing's come back somewhat to normal. Heart rate slowly coming back also. Thank you everybody for joining in for that quick exercise bit.
Fantastic, Kausu. Thank you so much. Hereby just trying to define sleep a little bit from the point of view of Yoga Sutras, Patanjali's Yoga Sutras. So Patanjali Yoga Sutra talks about the first most important part it talks about is yoga is vritta chitta vritti nirodha, right? So it talks a lot about vrittis, behaviors, one of which is nidra, right? So sleep is very, very important behavior that an individual needs to work on, understand, go deeper, explore in order to understand one's own states. So if consciousness is the chitta, vrittis or the ripples that come out of it are all behaviors. And one of those is sleep. So, and how does Patanjali define the entire aspect of nidra is very, very interesting. So nidra, Patanjali calls it abhava pratyayalambana vrittir nidra. Abhava pratyayalambana, which means that it is an absence of thought, absence of activity even of your brain, or absence of knowledge. So most importantly, it is a state which comes to you, you know, involuntarily. It's an involuntary state where thinking becomes absent. So where active thinking and knowledge is on, it's not real state of sleep as we actually can understand it. So Kaustubh, I have a question for you, that getting thinking out of our way is where exercise really helps. Okay, and focusing on the body really gets you a little away from, you know, focusing on thoughts. Okay, so what is your experience when dealing with exercise? How does it exactly help you improve sleep? And are there any bad exercise that can disturb sleep?
Okay. The first bit about quieting the mind, I think, comes very easily. If you ever decide to do 108 Surya Namaskar, just the practice of counting to 108 will make sure all other thoughts are put on the other side of your mind. Starting as simply as that, but also doing any mundane or repetitive activity again and again, very close to what a job would be, or performing cyclical activities again and again and again, which is a lot of the times what exercise is, itself is a very calming and soothing action. And even though it starts at the physical level, it by default filters through, I think, to the mental. And that sort of rhythm calms down a lot of activity and thoughts that may be unwanted at certain times. That being said, I believe that both sleep and exercise are sort of underutilized with modern life. But if there's too little exercise also, or too little stimulation physically, that could make you want to sleep less. Or sort of, on the other hand, exercising more till the right extent would help sort of put that cycle into balance. You tire yourself enough that you feel like you deserve a good night's sleep. But what I have experienced is sometimes these spikes of activity where you overdo something, maybe sometimes even physically, as, oh, today I decided I want to walk 10 kilometers extra, sometimes makes it difficult to fall asleep into a quality night's sleep, which though on that exact day is when you need it the most. So then when you do those, have those activities on those days, it's just good to be mindful that what can I do behavior-wise to help settle into a better sleep, instead of saying, because I'm exhausted, I'm not going to use.
Absolutely. Fantastically put, Kaustubh. I feel this important aspect of equilibrium when it comes to various activities or exercise, because I have myself experienced while doing exercise, sometimes it just gets overexciting to go ahead and do, you know, too much. And if it is wrongly combined with not really great eating or resting habits or certain other things that you do in the day, it can really hamper the sleep. So the equilibrium aspect is very crucial over there. In one of the one of the, I wouldn't call it sutras, but in one of the shlokas, Vagbhat, who is a Ayurvedacharya, he talks again about sleep, very, very, very interesting stuff that he talks about. So he says, Nidra yattam sukham dukham, pushtih karsham balabalam, vrushata klibata jnanam, adjnanam jivitam cha. I'll explain this Sanskrit shloka, which means that everything depends on sleep. Sukha, dukha, your happiness and sorrow. Pushtih karsham means your, you know, you being fat and you being thin depends on sleep. Bala balam, having enough strength and less strength. Vrushata, klibata, potency and impotence. And then jnanam and adjnanam, knowledge and ignorance, also depends on sleep. And the last thing that he talks about, Vagbhat talks about sleep, where jivitam, life and death, also depends on sleep. And I think not more comprehensive definition than this. You know, you cannot get, the definition of sleep cannot get better than Nidrayattam sukham dukham pushtih karsham balabalam vrushata klibata jnanam adjnanam jivitam cha. So to the extent that life and death also depends on sleep, which means that illness and health, okay, both are significantly regulated. And to have a healthy state, sleep is something that is very, very, very important, right? So why I did refer some bit of Yoga Sutras and some bit of Vagbhata's Ayurveda concepts is because it has a slightly more comprehensive outlook towards what sleep is or what sleep means. And during the entire exercise piece also, we feel that having enough physical effort is one of the interesting things, because during lockdowns, people were doing their own physical effort at home by themselves, and it was giving more joy than grief to people. Saying that in the beginning, people were frustrated. Everybody was frustrated. But then later on, enough physical effort and the need for it was very well understood. Kaustubh, right now we were sleeping prone. Okay. So there are variations of Shavasana. So there are Shavasana variations. So where you hang your legs a little up, or sometimes you also do Shavasana in a prone position. So just to show, you know, the position of, you know, just before Makarasana. Okay, typically we call it as, you know, prone Shavasana. Lying down on your stomach also sometimes gives you much better relief. And we say that, okay, when your back is overloaded or certain asanas that really load your back, we say that, okay, you go for, you know, prone Shavasana. And prone Shavasana helps in these situations where you are, you know, lying down onto your stomach. What is your experience with exercise? How does prone Shavasana help you?
I think both would help, depending on, like you said, what activity we've done. Either way, which way the core has been sort of worked or overworked. Core being not just the front, but say your whole torso from your hips all the way to your shoulders. Prone Shavasana, I think, would be great in conditions where you've either worked a lot of the abdomen also or the back. While I would go for your regular Shavasana with the feet raised for most other days with relaxation and then irrespective of activity. Otherwise, I think it's useful for most individuals considering their day-to-day schedule.
Absolutely. Super. Thank you so much, Kaustubh. We are going back to, you know, all our SmickFitters now, where I would like all of our SmickFitters to contribute a little bit with a couple of questions that I have for everybody. So maybe moving me out of the spotlight and putting spotlight onto everyone is going to help. I'm going to remove my spotlight and remove Katie's spotlight as well and getting into a gallery view. I can see everyone now. I have a small question for everybody, that when it comes to sleep or when it comes to certain disturb, four things that immediately come to my mind. One is, you know, falling asleep is a challenge sometimes. Being in a quiet sleep state where stopping one's own thoughts is one factor where it becomes difficult to sleep. Third thing is where sometimes certain panic situations where you suddenly wake up because of, you know, sudden things that happen at night. So getting disturbed with your sleep is the third or fourth problem that or challenge that, you know, we face. And the last one being oversleeping or not being able to wake up. So sometimes people like me, you know, go for that. You over tend to overexercise someday and you're like, you felt asleep for so long. What is it that all of you experience in terms of challenges in sleep? And what have you associated it to for yourself? What are certain challenges for sleep?
So if I generally don't sleep in time, if I'm up until very late, it becomes difficult for me to go to sleep. One good thing that I have realized is if I lie down reading something, newspaper or anything, within about 15 minutes, I start feeling drowsy. I generally go off to sleep pretty fast. As it is, I'm a light sleeper. I have seen that generally if I sleep 5 hours, anything over 4.5 to 5 hours, I'm done. That's good enough. And I feel pretty fresh even after a 5 hour sleep.
Superb. Thank you, Kedarji. Today with us, we also have Malaji. And Malaji, welcome for the Friday evening session. And we do this weekly and we are really happy to see you over here in the session. And we would definitely like you to also share about your thoughts on you know, certain things that happened with you. So for everybody's knowledge, we today have Mala Ramadurai ji, and Mala Ramadurai ji is a you know, wonderful classical singer, and you know, you should listen to what she has sung before, and she's, you know, it'll be nice to, you know, hear from her as well about you know, whatever we are chatting. Mala ji, over to you.
You're on mute.
Yeah, she's on mute.
This happens very often in my school also. When you need the children to unmute, they don't. So that's what happened to me now. Okay. Happy to be here. Nice to see all of you. I think sleep is a very important thing, which probably is the one thing that I am not experiencing very well, because I have gone, of course, on my own personal research on low carb, and I have and I'm also I think I have a good exercise regimen also. So I'm quite puzzled, and the only thing which I can put my finger to right now is sleep. And I think sometimes when I do a proper organized, and I say I have done all the things I need to do today, then I'm able to sleep better. If I have something in my mind which is kind of troubling me, even though I look quite relaxed and everybody else thinks that I'm very relaxed, I don't think I am. I think internally there is a buildup of some kind of tension, and I think that plays on my glucose level, my sugar level. I'm diabetic. So naturally, I think that is one thing which I would like to control. Not control, but at least influence, let's say. So that is my take on this.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Malaji. And thank you for sharing your experience. And during these sessions, it's such a wonderful thing that now, you know, across last so many sessions, we have known each other so well in terms of, you know, various of our behaviors as well as various of our things that we have been able to overcome by different means. And we just have these sharings over here, and these sharings work as, you know, different sorts of learnings. So thank you so much for sharing in. And Vibhor, I'm going to come to you. We have Dozy as our friend for sleep, a friend that tells us whether you have slept right, whether you have not sleeping right, whether so you are our guide on that. So some thoughts from your side, Vibhor.
Can everyone hear me?
Yes,
yeah.
We can.
Yeah, hi. I have some poor internet right now, so glad to meet you all and cross the great workout session and the sleep, Anand. It was beautifully put how sleep works, actually what sleep is. So so generally put, how am I audible? I'm a bit confused. Okay. Yeah. So, what sleep is basically is when you lose every control over your body, anything voluntary. You lose the control of the movements, the breathing, any exertion, any stress. When you're releasing that thing, that is basically sleep. So, what people have done means we have been sleeping since the time we were born, but lately, like in 70 years back, we started researching about it, what exactly sleep is. So what we figured out that sleep is basically divided into five type of stages. These are being awake, when you are totally up, aware of your surroundings. Then there is something called N1, N2, N3 and REM sleep. I guess REM sleep, everyone would be familiar with the name REM sleep. It's basically called rapid eye movement. And N1, N2 and N3 sleeps are basically light sleep and deep sleep. So I will be talking about these kind of sleeps, what we have and what's the implication of these things. So in deep sleep, what happens? So look, people say that, right? That I woke up, I'm not feeling well rested or something.
If
like that.
Sorry to interrupt you for a moment. You're awake, N1, N2, N3, and then REM. So
yes.
N1 is what, N2 is what, and N3 is what?
Okay, yeah. So N1 and N2 combined are called light sleep. N3 is basically your deep sleep. And then there is REM sleep. N1, N2, N3 combined are called non-REM sleeps. So these are basic classifications of that. So talking about N3 and REM. So when people say that they are not feeling well rested or something like that, right, after the sleep, that is when they have not got enough deep sleep, which is N3. So deep sleep is basically help us to recover from all our physical activities throughout the day, all the mental stress which you had. You had a session with someone, you had a call with someone, you were in office, you had exercises, every physical stress which you have, N3 helps you recover from those things. So that is what deep sleep is for. Then there is REM sleep. So think of our brain as a computer. Okay, you learn everything, every day you learn something new. And then you learn something new every day. Now you have to store it in your C drive, D drive, E drive, something like that, right? So that is where a REM sleep comes in. It helps you in memory consolidation that, okay, this is this information, I need to store it in this part of the brain. And this is some technical information I need to store in this part of the brain. So that is where REM sleep comes in. And what light sleep is basically is that it helps you transition between a deep sleep and a REM sleep. So when you start sleeping, you start with light sleep, you transition into deep sleep, and then you move to REM sleep. And then you again transition to a light sleep, then deep, then REM. So this one particular cycle called from light, deep to REM, this complete cycle is called one cycle of sleep, one sleep cycle basically. It generally takes like 90 to 110 minutes for a cycle to complete if you are sleeping in a very optimal way, in a very fantastic way. So what happens in these kind of sleep is when you start sleeping, deep sleep, in the starting phase of the sleep, your physical recovery is more, you get more deep sleep. As you move towards the end of the sleep, then the amount of REM sleep starts to increase and deep sleep starts to decrease. So people generally say that, okay, 4 hours of sleep is enough for me and then I can go and tackle the world and these kind of things, right? So means it's good to do that. But again, they don't understand that it is hampering their health, their cardiovascular health, their mental health and everything in that way. You need at least 6, 7 to 9 hours of sleep. And as we age, right, our sleep cycles change. We do, as we age, we don't get enough deep sleep, enough REM sleep. That's why while aging, we say that, okay, you can sleep more, sleep for 11 hours. That's not a problem, right? Even for very healthy people, if you're exercising, like I'm pretty sure, means Costa is working out on a daily basis and has a full health routine, right? He must be sleeping like for 9 hours. The more you work, the same amount of sleep you should get. Means that helps you stress out your body and stress yourself, basically reduce the stress levels of your body. So this is how the sleep stages work, sleep cycles work. So then there is a very important part of sleep which is called circadian rhythm. So I guess circadian rhythm, I guess everyone must have heard about it. It's basically our body clock, how our body identifies, okay, this is the time I should be up, this is the time I should be sitting down and just relaxing, this is the time I should sleep. So generally our parents used to say that, come on, wake up early, start your day early, study at that time and sleep also, early to bed, early to rise, right? So our body maintains a clock. By 11 p.m. or something, you start getting that kind of a tendency that you sleep. And by 6, 7, you start a tendency that you should wake up. Now, why when people don't do that, they don't follow their circadian rhythm, or they are like awake for the full night, you must have seen that many people snack up during that time, right? Means you feel like eating and you don't feel like eating some healthy food. You feel like eating some oily, crispy, those kind of food. Basically what happens as you are not sleeping, at that time there's a hormone called ghrelin hormone. That levels starts to rise. This hormone is basically your hunger hormone. It makes you feel hungry. And during the night, it starts to rise. And when that levels are increasing, you feel like snacking that, okay, I should have a bhujia or something oily or a pakoda or something like that. You feel like having those kind of things. So that is one thing. The second thing so this is like when you are not sleeping at the correct time. So you feel like hungry. Now, if you are having this, now this will lead to several other disorders, which is like your cardiovascular disorders, your diabetes, your kidney disorders, right? You start munching on different things. You don't get enough sleep. You don't recover from whatever you have done. You don't do that. So these things start getting on to you. Then there is a morning thing. We don't get up on time. So why we should get up on time? It's not that you just get up on time at 6 o'clock and just be at your home. That's not enough. Why we have to get up on time is that we can go out and take sun. We need vitamin D. What vitamin D basically helps us is that you get energy to do things. It activates your body cells that, okay, yes, I'm ready for the day. So just getting up in the morning and just roaming around in the house is not enough. You should go to your balcony. You should go to your window and just feel the sun. That's a very important thing. Means that's the most natural source of vitamin which we have, and still we take medicines for it, right? You can directly get that. So that's why means the doctors or experts or anyone suggest we should have vitamin D.
Right.
Means we should go out in the sun, right?
Yeah.
That is really important.
Vibhor, I'm going to ask one small question to Swati about the late night munching bit. Because moment Vibhor spoke about eating, you know, I'm sure Swati has much more to contribute on that. So, Swati, when you're talking about late night munching or this need to have some food at night, and also the evening food or the dinner that we have, right? The entire cycle of when you eat and what you eat, okay, is connected to sleep definitely. So some recent experiments that I have seen where people eat slightly early and get good sleep, or all of these things. So I want to push this question to you and maybe hear from you a little bit about late night munching and right habits of eating towards sleep.
Right. So am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. So, you know, I was very happy because you, you know, pointed out that this, because many a times, especially with people who eat an early dinner, but who don't tend to, you know, retire early, it so happens that it is very natural that they start feeling hungry after 4 or 5 hours. Let's say, for example, people who adopt a very healthy habit of eating around 6:30 or 7:30, but they don't retire early, and then if they are up, maybe watching TV or working also most of the time, around 12:31, obviously they will start feeling hungry, and that is the time, you know, instead of reaching out for something healthy like a mug of milk, it will in fact increase the chances of a sound sleep. Many a times, because of this sleep deprivation, there is more inclination towards more textured foods and more sharp tasting foods, and that's where all these chips and munching come into picture. So it's very important that you understand your hunger well and make choices which are. I think the first choice would be to retire early. That's the best thing that you can do to your body after having an early dinner. Getting up early in the morning is a better idea than staying up late. So if you have to finish some work, might as well call it a day early, wake up early, maybe do your exercise and start your day early. But staying up late and looking for these options may not be a good idea. It deserves the whole purpose of having an early dinner.
So, Anand, I had one observation, which is, as Mala ma'am said as well, we are all in the journey of understanding ourselves better. Right? Some parts we understand, some parts not so much. And I'm in that same camp where I never understood the sleep impact. There are some days where you wake up and feel lousy, and there are some days which are the complete opposite. Right? So, I think, Vibhor, we should think about or discuss how can each of us understand sleep better? Because it feels like that is one part that we probably don't understand very well. Second, we did a dipstick, about a month and a half back, where many of our participants went through a CGM exercise. And we found that many of us, me included, by the way, had early morning hypoglycemia kind of, not every day, but it was there, right? 4 a.m., 5 a.m., quite a few of us had, right? So that's the other part, right? Which is impacting our diabetes and our control of the condition. And then we have obviously ideas like eat your dinner early, but then the flip side is then you end up snacking. So I think we need to find our own answers. So we should ask ourselves, what are the tools which will allow us to get to those answers? And I'm pretty sure it's a combination of nutrition, which Swati talks about, it's sleep, but you know, that's my feeling, Anand, right? The answers will be different for each one of us. There are no standard answers, right? So how do we get to the point where we know our own answers? Anand, are you saying something? Your voice is not clear.
Can you hear me now?
Yes. Hello.
Yeah. So from the far end of the yogis trying to analyze their own bodies, where, you know, from the asanas point of view, from the pranayam point of view, what's happening with my bandhas and chakras, know that far end of ability to introspect. Two, today's time when we have tools like Dozi, which are all tech-enabled solutions, what I feel is that going more and more deeper into the entire segment or entire timeline of your sleep and the preparation for sleep, as well as preparation for the right amount, intensity, depth, and quietness of sleep, is where I think observation is going to be a very, very important tool about what's happening on day-on-day basis. Second, it's links with various factors during the day. So comparing day and night with each other, you know, connecting these two points is going to be a second tool. And for this, I feel that Dozi is going to play a huge, huge role over here. And its integration, how we are looking at from the Smith point of view, is we are already tracking so many things during the day. We are already looking at the life plan. We are already looking at various aspects that we are supposed to do. And you are tracking the end of day summary. Where actually the end of day summary ends is where Dozi's work begins, I feel. And night tracking, I think, Vibhor, if you can spend a little bit of time on that, saying that, so actually, how is this tracking?
Yeah, so as you mentioned, means to know about more about ourselves, it has to be a combination of all. Means it has to be a mindfulness, it has to be your routine, and it has to be technology. So routine is a must, right? Means you have to follow a particular routine, that you have a diet at a specific time. So your body is used to follow some routine. You need to have some good exercises, and then you need to have a good sleep, right? And see, we spend like 1/3 of our lives sleeping, and we don't do anything about it. We don't know about anything that what we were doing about it. So that's where Dozi comes into picture, right? Where we understand that, okay, suddenly your vitals are increasing when you are seeing your heart rate graph. So while we are tracking your full body vitals, suppose at 5 o'clock, as you were saying, that the hypoglycemia levels were decreased. There were some events for hypoglycemia. At that time, you can observe that at that time, either the heart rate of the person would be shooting up, or it might be shooting down. It can be an indication for an early diabetic thing, or it can be a indication for any other disease also. So tracking your resting heart rate, when you are properly resting, tracking those kind of vitals becomes very important, because it can indicate what your body is actually feeling. Because at that time, you don't have that adrenaline rush which is going on with your life.
Great. Thanks, Vibhor. I would again throw it a little bit open for everybody to share their own thoughts or experiences or experiments that have worked for you. Towards the end of session, you know, we would also like to hear from anybody whose experiments have worked. Sudhirji, I think you unmuted, so would like to hear from you.
Yeah, my experience is that suppose before going to sleep, I'm thinking about something. Then in the first phase of the sleep, like 3-4 hours, I typically wake up, and that time the first thought in the head is what you are thinking just before you went to sleep. So what I found out that just listening to some relaxing music like 15-20 minutes before sleeping, that helps. Otherwise, the first time you wake up from the first phase of the sleep, that is 3-4 hours in my case, the immediately the first thought in your head is what you are thinking before going to sleep. So listening to some relaxing music for at least 10-15 minutes helps in this case.
Sure. That's great. Yeah,
that is actually a very good idea.
So, and, Vibhor, one thing I wanted to know. See, if I go through my Dozi report, you know, the respiration as well as the heart rate is within the healthy range. But yet, you know, the sleep pattern, somehow, you know, the total number of hours of sleep and for example, like yesterday, it was light sleep 206 minutes, deep 68 minutes, REM was 71 minutes. So what should be a kind of a standard thing? So is there a ratio of light, deep and REM, or what is it?
Generally sleep is, the more you get deep sleep, the more you get REM sleep, that is better. But as you age, right, it changes from person to person. Now, for males, while they are aging at, let's say, around 40s and 50s, they will somewhere around get 50 minutes of sleep, deep sleep, or 60 minutes of deep sleep. And while they are age more, 60 or something, and they are not very healthy, they start getting very less, 20 minutes or 30 minutes. That's why we see that many people don't are not very active. They are always tired. So as we age, and we, if we are maintaining our routine, 60 minutes of deep sleep can be a very good thing. But if you are not doing the routine, not following a complete routine or something, it will decrease to 30 and 20. That is not a very a great thing to have.
Okay. So anything between 60 and 85, that is what I've been seeing for the past. Is that a good enough sleep? Deep sleep?
That is good enough for deep sleep. Okay. Means I don't know your age. I think that you are very young. So
yeah, I'm young, man.
Energy. See, that's where you are 5 hours, 5.5 hours, 6 hours in total. Also is very powerful. You okay. See that 80, 85 minutes of deep sleep.
Yeah.
Right?
And, 60 minutes you are talking per cycle or for 7 hours?
For 7 hours. When you are sleeping for 7 hours. Okay. So, means when you are very young, like 18 years, 20 years, 30 years, you get like 100, you can get 100 minutes of deep sleep. But as we grow old, we have more and stress coming in and our lifestyle is deteriorating. We don't exercise much. It starts to decrease. It goes to 55. So if you go and read about sleep and read some research papers, so they define that, okay, at the age of 60, 60 plus, you should at least get 65 minutes, 70 minutes of deep sleep. Your REM sleep will again decrease around 50 minutes, 60 minutes. It depends. So different researches suggest different things. But again, if you are getting like 70 minutes and 80 minutes of deep sleep and REM sleep, that is a good enough number.
Or can I make a suggestion? This group is very analytically oriented and they do their own research kind of group. So can you circulate the 2 or 3 best research papers? Trust me, there are many who will actually read it from start to finish, including the footnotes. So
definitely, I can share those papers with you.
Yes. Which sleep we get the dreams?
A REM sleep. Maximum deep dreams are comes in REM sleep.
Any reason for that?
Yeah. So what happens in REM sleep is basically called, full form is rapid eye movement. So what happens at that time, your body, your brain is basically exactly behaving like when you are awake. The only difference between awake and REM sleep is that your body is paralyzed at that time. Your hands don't move. Else what will happen, that if you are dreaming that you are riding a horse and your body is not paralyzed at that time, you will start enacting that thing and then you will start running for that. So at that time, everything starts, memory consolidation happens and these things happen. There are specific type of brain waves which generate. Your eyes start to move, your muscle tension reduces very much, and then you get REM sleep.
Absolutely. And I think that was the time when Freud was at maximum work and he wrote the book called Interpretation of Dreams. And typically, psychologists have a huge basis of interpreting sleep and dreams, which also gives a great understanding on the areas of conscious, pre-conscious and unconscious, as we call it typically. So the hidden areas of our life, which are unexpressed, tend to be expressed during the dreams, and there are various theoretical foundations for that also. And I'm sure that it will be interesting to have another separate session on just on dreams. It is as powerful a topic that it's we can keep discussing on that. But Patkarji, thank you so much for bringing out that question. It was very important because dreams are as much soothing that they can get to as much disturbing that they can be. And they are a very important part of our life.
So, one technical question, when will dozy start capturing dream time?
Dreams.
Dream time.
No, not dreams, only dream time.
Yeah, so we detect stages. Dream time, I'm not sure whether EEG also can do that. So very interesting thing. I'll tell you one experiment. It's called a lucid dream. So lucid dreaming is when our consciousness starts knowing that you are dreaming. And then your brain starts controlling what will happen in that dream. Okay, so that is something called lucid dreaming. So some good people in Enhance and in over the world are working on those projects. So what happens, they put in earphones on person's on ears, and they do a very small exercise. They ask their subjects to prepare themselves for a week. They go in front of the mirror and ask, is this a dream? Okay, do this exercise daily. When you sleep and you start getting dreams, you will have some moment when you will realize, is this a dream? So you will start and look for a mirror and you will ask whether it's a dream. And at that time, that glass would be wavy or something, and you will realize that is a dream. Okay. And at that time, you can, so what they were experimenting, if they can induce lucid dreaming. Now, why lucid dreaming is important? It can burst your stress like anything. So there was one example which the researchers shared there. So there was one person who was very much stressed with their work. So they were experimenting this thing. So they asked him to do this exercise, and also on the earphones, when the REM sleep starts, they slowly give a music, this is a dream, this is a dream, this is a dream, kind of a thing. So that guy was dreaming about sitting with his boss in a conference room and talking about something, and he realized it was a dream, what he explained the next morning. And he realized it was a dream. He he stood up, he slapped his boss and took all his anger, and next morning he was feeling so great because what he wanted to do, he performed that in the dream.
Superb.
Hey, Vibhor, just tell me, not very many people will remember what they dreamt in the morning.
Yes.
If it's only probably early morning, if you have a dream, then maybe that, you know, people will be able to tell what they dreamt of.
Yes. So actually, we all dream at throughout the night, means whenever the REM sleep is there, might be in deep sleep. Researchers are still on that. But so that is something the brain is not, I'm not sure, means it is not supposed to remember that thing, because it is doing some other activities. It is something when you are relaxing, right? Sometimes, as Anand was saying, that some particular dreams have some implication for psychology, that this particular stress is going on in your life, and that's why you're getting the same dream again and again and again. But generally, you don't remember your dreams. And immediately, suppose you are in REM sleep and I wake you up, at that time, you might remember. But it is never for sure that you will remember your full dreams.
Yeah, and research says, Kedarji, that very short percent of dream is remembered, and by very few people. Also, there are some researches ongoing in the parapsychology field where dreams and typical dreams about certain other aspects that work as intuitions, where some people see certain things about intuitive aspects within the sleep. But there is a lot going on sleep as sleep research. And I think it was a very, very insightful discussion and a thought-provoking one. Kaustubh has put some resource over here about a book from Amazon. Kaustubh, thank you so much for putting that book. There is a lot of research about sleep in that book. Suvarna says that deep breathing and gratitude practices just before sleep have helped to get good and sound sleep. So thanks on that. These tips are helpful. Ketki, over to you. Sorry.
So I just want to mention a few words that, especially when you mentioned, Kedarji, that there are a few dreams that we remember and a few we do not. So from a psychology point of view, right, it especially states that most of these dreams that you do remember or that you recurrently see in your dreams are the ones that our subconscious mind is trying to draw attention to. then again, there are no proofs on of this on a screen, because this is something which cannot be proved on any of the biological Western medicine techniques. But a lot of famous psychologists have stated that our dreams keep representing symbolic meanings of things that are happening in our lives. And if there is a dream that you clearly, very distinctively remember, it is a dream that probably points towards an area in your life that you may need to pay attention to. Yeah, that's all that I wanted to say about this.
Okay.
Cool. Thank you.
So next time I remember something, I should actually jot it down.
Absolutely. Kedarji, and that's a good practice.
That memory is a very short-lived memory. Probably in the morning, first thing I may remember, but after that, it's kind of hazy. I will not.
Fair enough. Kedarji, there is actually something called as dream journaling, and it is a part of, you know, a lot of therapy sessions wherein these exercises are given to keep a journal of your dreams, because they depict a lot of things about the kind of phase of life you're in right now and where you need to be headed towards.